AMD released in 2021 the Radeon RX 6600, a graphics card that offered decent 1080p gaming performance. However, the majority of tech community evaluated it as an uninspiring and expensive cutout version of an already average chipset with limited memory bandwidth and weak ray tracing capabilities. This video is going to illustrate the reasons why a used RX 6600 is today not just one of the top priced performance graphics cards, but in the near future it has all the potential to be the overall value king of the second-hand GPUs. I am not going to waste much time by presenting the specifications of our today's guest. If you are not familiar with Sapphire RX 6600 polls, a quick internet search will reveal everything you need to know about this specific graphics card and an extension on every AMD 6600 chipset. Instead, I will jump without further ado into the benchmarks, because I believe it will be more interesting to discover the ray tracing capabilities or how much of performance improvement the RX 6600 gained as AMD's drivers got more mature. I suppose it must be some kind of performance gain, right?
Wrong.
To find out the correct answer, I will test the RX 6600 under 10 games. At native 1080 and 4040 resolutions, playing around with ray tracing, FSR and smart access memory features at stock and overclock speeds. For those who wonder about the rest of the computer parts I use to run the games, please check the hardware specifications in the description below. Having got all that out of the way, let's begin the tests with a game that, even though it has seen better days, is still one of the most popular games in the world. Trying to play Fortnite with an RX 6600 was absolute disaster. Right from the start, the game popped out a message warning about driver issues and suggesting to update the AMD drivers. A bit baffling for me, since I was already running AMD's latest recommended and trustworthy drivers. Ha! Warning messages are for the weak, said pridefully a rebellious thought.
Psst, press no to see what will happen,
whispered the voice of curiosity. So, here I was, totally disregarding Epic Games' advice and running the game with the drivers that I had already used to test all the games of the present content. Unfortunately, and despite my hopes, the warning message was true to its prophecy. There was a very good reason why I didn't include Fortnite in my benchmarking shoot the last 3 months, but it never crossed my mind that things would evolve from bad to terrible. Playing Fortnite with DirectX 12 at 1080 Epic settings records some satisfying average frame rate. However, the 1% low was horrible, generating some very notable and frequent gameplay stutters. The notion that I was working on a fresh Windows 10 installation was enough to direct my attention to the usual scapegoat, the AMD drivers. Therefore, I had to close my ears to the ignorant rebellious voices, update to the most recent optional drivers, and reboot the game. This time, everything was running like exactly like before. Choosing high or even pro settings changed nothing. Switching to DirectX 11 or performance mode didn't change much. I verified the game, reinstalled it. I used the DDU application to remove completely the drivers and install them again, but nothing was able to fix the problem. The only thing I observed was that after a good 15 to 20 minutes of gameplay on performance mode, the frame timeline became less erratic. I don't know who is to be blamed for, but both Epic and AMD must figure out what's going on, since this doesn't flatter either of them. Needless to say that the first benchmark didn't start with the right foot. And not pun intended for the left-footed people. So let's try another popular title that is preferred mostly by people who like the anime-style open-world RPGs. Genshin Impact at 1080p high settings and uncapped frame rate runs totally smoothly at 132 average frames and 90 in 1% low. At 1440 resolution, the RX 6600 continues to produce high frame rates well above the minimum 60. Despite that, I spot some minor stutters here and there while gaming. Obviously, if you don't unlock the frames per second like I did and run the game as it is, the overall experience will remain flawless. Halo Infinite is one of the titles that none of the RX graphics cards we have tested so far in this channel have managed to keep the minimum 1% low above 60fps while playing at 1080p high settings. That's why the performance of RX 6600 in multiplayer mode was a welcome change, offering 95 and 61 average and 1% low frames respectively. At 1440p, even though the 1% low dropped to 50 frames per second, the overall gameplay wasn't bad at all. Keep in mind that if you want to keep the above performance while playing campaign mode, you will have to switch the video settings to medium. Next, we have the usual triplet from Ubisoft's Games Basket, with Assassin's Creed Valhalla being the most demanding one. At 1080 high settings and average frame rate 80 with 1% low 53, I've seen a few instances of screen tearing, but nothing too troublesome. On the other hand, at 4040 resolution, the benchmark runs poorly, barely reaching the high 50s on average and only 17 in the 1% low. Far Cry 6 gave way better results on both resolutions. 1080 high settings and the RX 6600 offered 108 average and 81 in the 1% low. At 1440p, the 62 and 52 average and 1% low respectively were barely sufficient for smoothly play. The Division 2, better optimized for our CPU than the above two titles, records some very high frames at 1080 high preset. High frame numbers I've seen also when I switched to 1440 resolution with the benchmark running without any hitch. The old and trusty built-in benchmark of Shadow of the Tomb Raider gave buttery smooth frame timeline with high frame rates at 1080p and high settings. At 4040 resolution, the GPU offered again great results with 81 and 73 on average and 1% low respectively. The list continued with Agent Bold from Hitman 3 and the Dubai Scene. 1080 high settings and high frame numbers. Nothing but greatness for our RX 6600. No sweat, even on the 4040p test, indicating that most titles will have no problem to run at frame rates well above 60 at high resolutions. I must underline the phrase most titles, since I don't yet have access to many well-known GPU demanding games like Cyberpunk 2077 or Elden Ring, but I have a worthy surrogate for that. Total War Saga Troy at high settings, 1080 resolution and 8 times DLA sync is able to bring to the knee most of the mid-tier GPUs, and the RX 6600 is no exception to this rule. The 42 average and 34 in the 1% low is the very proof of that. I had to drop the DLA sync to just get a meager 66 on average, with the 1% low being 3 frames off from the minimum 60. If by chance you decide to play the game at 1440 resolution, then the medium video settings is the only viable option for a satisfactory outcome. Finishing this benchmark segment, I drove a dozen of laps on the pitch of Grid Legends, a temporary replacement of Forza Horizon 5. At 1080 high preset settings, we get 130 average and solid 1% low of 64fps. Camera mode was a bit more taxing on average frames per second, but nothing too worrisome. The same game at 1440p kept high average FPS, but the 1% low plummeted at 14.6 frames per second. Changing into camera mode made things a bit worse. Despite the SI 1% low, the gameplay experience was fine by my standards, without any obvious stutters. My next endeavor was to test of how much of performance improvement we can get with the RX 6600 while enabling AMD software technology called SAM, or otherwise Smart Access Memory. Assassin's Creed Valhalla with the disappointing 4040p high settings benchmark run on the left of the screen as a base was the perfect candidate to check SAM's performance improvement. The end results while switching to SAM on showed a noticeable improvement in frame rates on average, and most importantly, at the previous awful 1% low, jumping from 59 and 17 to 68 and 49 frames per second respectively. Here it is, one more example of performance difference with SAM off while running Far Cry 6 at 1080 resolution high settings, and now with SAM on. This time the performance gain is lower. This is quite normal, since different game titles will have different performance increments. noticeable or less noticeable, the improvements are real. Therefore, if you own a Radeon 6000 series combined with a Ryzen 5000 or 3000 series processor and a motherboard with AGSA 1.1 UA5 BIOS, make sure to enable the Smart Access Memory both on BIOS and AMD's Adrenaline software. For more details, refer to your motherboard's manual. Whether or not people will treat the RX 6600 as a mainstream mid-tier GPU, it is always welcome to know that this card is fully able to run specific games with ray tracing. The question is, at how many frames per second? And the answer lies within the current benchmark of Far Cry 6 running at 1080p high settings and DRX on. Although the obvious increase of graphics quality compared to the native resolution, the GPU remains capable to offer pretty solid FPS. For those in doubt about whether the card is suitable for 4040p ray tracing, here it is one more benchmark run at the resolution equation with DRX enabled. Despite the 53fps result within 1% low, I will say that the FPS outcome is not shabby at all. In fact, if you go to video settings and enable FSR options at ultra quality, you will have a sound gameplay experience, keeping almost the same video fidelity similar to the native 4040p resolution. Undoubtedly, there will be plenty of modern titles that will bring the RX 6600 at the knee with ray tracing on. Titles such as Hitman 3, that even at 1080p high settings and RTS on, will drop the average frames per second at low 30s and the 1% low will dip below 10fps. Enabling the FSR 2 options, it can partially fix the performance drop, but not by much, just enough to get frames similar to an 8th gen game console. I wonder, what will be your reaction if I said to you that there is a new scaling technique that your graphics card can take advantage of, but most probably you completely ignore? You see, beyond the FSR upscaling technique that is enabling the current video footage while running the Shadow of Tomb Raider, there is also the option of Intel's Overclock XeSS scaling implementation that introduced very recently along with the ARC GPUs. Even though XeSS is being supported by very few games, it will be unwise to not take advantage of it, if it has to offer higher FPS than the competition, of course. In fact, comparing side-by-side FSR with XeSS, we see a performance difference of 70% in favor of the latter technique, while keeping the graphics quality at very decent levels. I'm not saying that Intel's upscaling method is always superior to Nvidia's or AMD's, but it is worth trying whenever you have the opportunity to. There is one more solution that I will consider viable if you want to improve the overall frame numbers of an RX 6600. This is the solution of overclocking. The side-by-side comparison at stock and overclocked frequencies, while the card is running once more the Total War Saga Troy at 1080p high settings, is a small display of the GPU's power limitations, maxing out at 120W. At 1440 resolution medium settings, the performance boost fluctuates at the same levels. Clearly, the RX 6600 doesn't grant dramatic overclocking capabilities. However, even the smallest gains are definitely useful for those who need the extra 5fps improvement at crucial 1 and 0.1% low FPS. Taking into account our benchmark findings, the Sapphire Radeon RX 6600 polls, and by extension AMD's RX 6600 chipset, provides great gaming performance at 1080p on the majority of AAA titles today, and solid 1440p gaming on most recent and every older game. The RX 6600 is based on AMD's latest and greatest architecture and considers a rather safe purchase in the used GPU market compared to the geriatric competition of GTX 1080s and 1070s, or even to the 6GB VRAM Turing and first-gen RDNA GPUs. Beyond that, we have in our hands some of the latest and greatest technologies like ray tracing, RSR, FSR, Smart Access Memory, denoiser, and many other goodies from AMD's Fidelity FX basket. If all that doesn't impress you yet, then let me add, its small size, its superior power efficiency, the silent fans and low temperatures along with the low power draw even when the card is overclocked. All the above makes the RX 6600 the right candidate to turn a low-budget office computer into a powerful game PC. It will be responsible of my part if I didn't point out the drawbacks I encountered during my tests and why you should think twice before you purchase an RX 6600. The first drawback is a common situation for the Team Red and pertains to the driver. Despite the software improvements through the years, the graphics drivers are unreliable, with frequent and constant updates that fix some issues while at the same time creating new ones. For example, it is unacceptable the Radeon Enhanced Sync, a technology created to prevent screen tearing and lag to induce gameplay stutters. Beyond the driver's optimization, AMD comes also second to Nvidia's in video editing capabilities. So, if you want higher driver reliability or you spend time with video editing, it is better to choose Team Green. The second problem is that, even with the occurring GPU price normalization, the RX 6600 continues to carry an overpriced tag almost everywhere in the world, with exception the USA, that you can find it as low as $220. The rest of us, we have to turn our gaze towards the second-hand market with the constantly increased availability of graphics cards. There, you can find a used RX 6600 at 70 to 60% off the price you pay today at your local market to buy a new one. At this price point, I can definitely consider the RX 6600 not just one of the top price-to-performance ratio GPUs, but also the absolute value king of 2022. It will also be of great value for us to leave your like if you enjoyed our content and subscribe to our channel if you haven't done so already. There is also the extra chore to press the notification bell if you don't want to miss our upcoming videos. Regardless, thanks for watching and see you on the next one.